A thinking man, a stressed man.
Yeah, like a little like, thing. I like the hat. I wish I had a hat on. That was kind of.
I like the hair, man. Healthy hair.
Dude, you gotta keep it good. Perfect. All good. Sweet, man. Well, first of all, thank you so much for joining us. I'm just going to do like a little kickoff of the series, and then we'll kind of start to vibe into some of these questions. We are being recorded, so if we like have hiccups or you want to like correct something or like, you know, not stumble over words, whatever, just feel free to reset and we can move at our own pace. One of the benefits of not being live.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
But I'm just going to do this little intro and then we can kind of go from there.
Cool.
All right. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the ExchangeArt Artist Workshop Series. We are super excited to be joined by John Lay today. And the point of the series is really to go in and explore the inner workings of what makes an artist tick, how they operate in the space, and some tips and tricks that they've learned along the way that could maybe benefit you someday. John, pleasure to be here with you, man.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. I'm very excited.
Also, congratulations. The whole trip looked absolutely beautiful and
thank you.
So much love.
Yeah. It's and it's especially nice to get away after such a hard sprint for the last, almost a year now. So it was nice to kind of train my brain to do nothing for a little bit. And
it's tougher than you think, huh?
It is. It got to a point where I'm sitting on the porch and every time I thought about doing something, it felt wrong. And I was like, okay, that's what that feels like, you know. So it's because, you know, it's over the years, it's just been hard to kind of afford that time. So it was, you know, very, very much needed, and I'm well rested and ready to get back to what I was doing before.
That's amazing, man. And you kind of touched on like this year-long sprint that I think many of us know you for, you know, this body of work for. But how long have you been an artist, and where did that kind of spark to become an artist start?
Yeah, so I think it probably started much earlier than I claim it did. But as far as drawing goes and illustration, it started when I was 22. So I'm 33 now. I'll be 34 next January. But it started when I was 22 in a cubicle at my corporate job. And I think it probably started before then. I think my obsession of creating something out of nothing started kind of early, whether it was nurtured or not. And, I trickled through many things of I sang in a band for a very short time in high school. And then I got really into graphic design around the same time. Later when I got into corporate America, I kind of leveraged my testing position to be a designer for them. So drawing just kind of came from kind of being at that office for so long and getting so bored and, wanting to do something a little different. Because once you kind of get into the motions of design, there's so many parameters around you of what you can do, what you can't do, how big. I did in-flight entertainment, so seatback units on a plane. So like, you know, everything had to be designed to the average size of a hand to like press the inputs and stuff like that. So, you know, not much of it felt like what I view as art now. So drawing started when I was 22. And I think it's a blessing more than a curse because at 22, it really lit a fire under my butt. You know, it was like, if you really want to change the course of your life, then, you know, you have to really push for it and really seek out the information to make yourself better. So yeah, it started maybe, now it's a good 12 years ago, been kind of at it ever since, you know.
Absolutely. Do you find that time you spent kind of, be it in that design world and then exploring your own art through that like almost like startup mentality, right, but through your own creation, do you feel like that kind of has helped you in Web3, that drive that you've had?
Yeah, and I would break it up into chapters, right? Because there was the time I was in corporate America and it taught me to be a professional. It taught me how to speak to different people. It taught me how to kind of be a chameleon based on who I was speaking to, whether that was a customer slash client or an engineer, or, you know, it taught me how to turn this off, turn it off and on and kind of change my verbiage to communicate properly. That is something that has stuck with me ever since. Another chapter that happened after the corporate America thing was there's a short moment that I was an apprentice under a screen printer slash illustrator named Dave Clock. And that taught me a lot about the art world as well, because it was the first time I was really hanging out with illustrators and I was spending a lot of time with them and understanding how they ran their businesses, how they ran their clients, stuff like that. So that was another small chapter. The next big chapter would be my time on Twitch. And my time on Twitch, I think that really got me to learn how to speak, and not just speak in the sense of, you know, speaking in conversation, but understanding the cadence of speech and understanding how to speak in a way that allows people to hang on every single word and pacing the cadence of speaking and how to be captivating towards an audience. So that helped a lot. That is what began my relationship with Adobe. I worked with them on their main channel for a couple of years, followed them to Behance and streamed on there for them as well. And the next chapters would be, after broadcasting, because of broadcasting, I was able to leave my corporate America job. And then after a while, I found out that broadcasting wasn't for me. So like throughout my life, it's kind of like I had an idea of what I wanted to do. And then what continued to happen is I trickled down the lane until I found my corner of like, okay, this is actually what I want to do. Because when you say that I want to do art, well, there's so many ways to go about it, right? Whether it's independent or studio or contract work or whatever. It's just, you know, it's a large buffet and you kind of have to figure out which part of that buffet do you want to dedicate a life to. So, from after I realized that broadcasting wasn't exactly what I wanted to do. However, that broadcasting time, that worked a lot like Web3. When I first came to Web3, I was like, wow, this is exactly like Twitch, the early days of Twitch, right? Where communities were hosted on three primary platforms, which was Twitch, of course, Discord and Twitter. So I started to understand what community meant in the online sense. And from there, as I had mentioned before, I started to realize that, okay, broadcasting art wasn't exactly what I wanted out of this career or this life or this journey. So then when I started drawing in 22, it was with the main goal to get to comics. Comics has this tendency to be a very ruthless mirror of what you don't know. You can fake a lot of standalone illustrations because you can cater everything to fit around your skill set. And don't get me wrong, I still do that today. But comics has a very ruthless kind of tendency to show you, like, if you don't know something, it's going to be very evident that you don't know it. And so it took me from 22 till I broke in at 30. I had trickled through all these different careers as an artist, and I realized that, you know, it was comics that I wanted to do. And I spent 10 years talking, or 8 years at that time, talking about comics more than I was making comics. So then I decided to make a change around 2016, 2017. And I started to focus a lot more on comics and understanding all the nuances that come with, there's a big difference, right? In standalone illustration or standalone images, we can imply a narrative, but we don't necessarily spoon feed a story where we control the cadence of in which that story is delivered. So I spent a couple years after retiring from broadcasting, and my only goal was to go forward with comics. And so breaking into comics is very difficult. And if anybody doesn't know, every year, I think there was a study done that only, I think the number back then when I looked it up was only 28 new illustrators are welcomed into comics a year. That's worldwide. And that's 28 that have never been published before finally get a shot. So throughout all those chapters, whether it was learning how to speak, learning how to captivate an audience, learning how to curate a community or nurture a community, and then learning how to be your own cheerleader for so long because everybody else thought that, oh, well, his chances aren't that likely. You know what I mean? It's going to be very hard because, you know, you say you want to do comics, but what have you actually done? So it gave me a very thick skin, and it gave me, I think what helps me most is where I'm at in my human journey is that I don't need approval and I don't need satisfaction or a constant fan base cheering me on. I've been able to, you know, comics kind of made a man out of me. I like to say it kind of sent me through boot camp because it just didn't care about those emotional things. It was like, you either want this or you don't. And for so long I had to, you know, when I was drawing my only comic credit or my only creator owned comic, which is Giga, you know, I was drawing that for maybe 2 years before anybody saw anything. And to go through 2 years of putting out work where your social media looks dusty and they're like, wow, he quit art. I had people tell me, it was like, wow, dude, glad you didn't quit. I was like, what do you mean quit? You know what I mean? Like I've been here at the desk every single day. So, you know, it's made Web3 in a way, and I don't want to come off as jaded or anything, but breaking into Web3 was much easier with the timing of everything, right? Especially my lane. My lane, I had gotten so incredibly lucky with the time in which I decided to start and all of those things. And so breaking into Web3, I didn't really have to break in like some people probably had to break in now, right? I got in when there was still very heavy speculation of whether or not Solana would nurture one of ones and stuff like that. So there wasn't that part of it, but it was more of Web3 became a time where the first 10 years of my career or first 11 or 12 or whatever, the first decade or so, I had only worried about craft, which I think was healthy for me. I didn't worry about monetization. I did sell work, but it was few and far between and definitely nothing to live on or tout about or anything. So it was, you know, I really had to understand the craft and what I wanted to do within that craft. The magical thing about what happened timing-wise with Web3 is that for the first time in my career, I understood that art is about craft. Art business is not about craft. Art business is about how well you can communicate to an audience that you are not only investable, but you are somebody with a body of work that you want to collect. You want to be a part of the journey. It took me a long time to do that. So that's kind of what helped me with my first collection was a lot of that work was the work I made to break into comics. So there was never this insecurity, right? Of like, I draw something, I was like, I hope people like it. It's just like, I know people like it because I made it 5 years ago. So when I started Web3, it was honestly I don't think handicap's the right word, but I had the luxury of not worrying about making the work. A couple of pieces in the first collection I did have to make new, but honestly, I don't know. I think from my perspective, once you get into comics, like everything else seems fairly easy, you know?
Yeah, man, it makes a lot of sense, right? Because so much goes into the pre-planning and then into the execution of that story frame that from there, it's kind of easy, right? It's like in that comic world, you're given this brief, this like, this is what you have to do. Mm-hmm. And the parameters, and then you just go and execute on that, right? So
right, like the way comics works is a writer generally gives you a script, and all writers are different, but they give you a script, but the script doesn't control the cadence, right? They're worried about the bigger picture of what is the emotional beats to hit. So when I get a script, it's, you know, just to kind of give insight on comics and everything is the writer comes in with the story and everything, but you as the artist, you're the wardrobe designer, you're the character designer, you're the set designer, the lighting designer, you are the director, and you are the cinematographer all in one. And so, you know, it's something I miss a lot because there were mornings where I would sit at the desk and I'd read the script and I was like, okay, this is what I had to draw today. And I would break down. I was like, how am I ever going to do this? I've never drawn anything close to that. You know what I mean? And that was every single day, multiple times a day. And so, and sometimes it's simple stuff, right? It's like a hand gesture or a look or right. something like that. I'm just like, I've never even come close to drawing that, right? And so it's something I miss greatly is that challenge of comics. And that's kind of why I'm steering everything I do more towards that and how we can solve that problem in Web3.
That's really cool, man. Yeah, it makes sense too. To the hardest times are like sometimes when you're put into a box, right? It's like, these are your confines. This is what you have to create. So it's like almost that freedom can be overwhelming at first, right?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Nothing to do but everything can be very terrifying.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So you kind of touched on that a little bit there, but how does that process of creation happen, right? We all know that you have this very distinct style that comes across with your illustration, but when you're coming up with that from concept to creation of your own work, where does that come from now with this, you know, newfound freedom?
Yeah, it's not much different, right? The craft is very much the same. Something that I am very grateful that I focused on early on in my career was there's a saying in illustration of like, does the brain guide the hand or does the pen guide the hand? And for me, I try to make sure it's the pen. I am here to do nothing more than to channel an energy, right? If I feel sad or happy or whatever, all I want to do is channel it through. I don't want to dictate an image. I want to discover an image. So that's something that I've just done for the bulk of my career, especially the latter half, is to allow myself to not let my brain guide it. I really very much just try to, I try to just kind of get my hand moving. Another thing that I've learned as I've become more of a professional illustrator is that when I was a kid, I used to think that you would sit on the couch and then boom, an idea comes. And yes, sometimes it does happen like that. But I think the clear difference is, at least for me, when you become a professional, is inspiration doesn't come unless you're actively doing something that opens the window for it to enter. And for me, that's drawing, right? For other people, it might be taking photos or being out on the street looking for photo opportunities or whatever. For me, it's very much about I have to be drawing, in the act of drawing, for that window to even open. So like, honestly, when I am put up to draft a new image, it's, you know, I know that the first 20 minutes to an hour will be extremely ugly. And that's not the point. The point at that stage for me is not to make something pretty. I learned a long time ago in my career, another thing I'm very grateful of, that making something pretty is very easy, I think. I think making people feel things is a completely different animal. And that's what I try to focus on more. I try to focus so much less on what it's going to look like, what the colors are going to be, or what it's going to sell for, or any of these peripheral things. I focus on the feeling that I'm trying to communicate, the conversation I'm trying to have. So, you know, I guess hopefully I answered the question all right. But like, I think for me, it's all about how do I continue to channel things? Like, and this goes with like Leidao too. Like Leidao, I don't make a list of like, oh, I should have a baker or I should have a this or that or whatever. I don't come up with the name first. For me, it's the act of drawing metaphorically is me sifting through the sand. And from that point, I meet this character. And that's when it becomes most natural to me. I think earlier on in my career, I had it the opposite way, as many young artists will. You think that it comes in a different kind of path. And so you try to control these things. But I think what happens is when you try to control things too much or you try to reference something too tightly, what happens is the drawing feels what I like to call guided. And I think that the true magic of mark making happens when it's unguided and it's undirected. It's just a person channeling an energy through an instrument, and then what comes out is raw and beautiful, and then you can massage it into beauty, because beauty is something that, okay, we know we're gonna solve all these problems to make something that's publishable and something that can be embraced and loved and understood. But then I don't think it ever starts there. You know, I think I would be a much different artist if I thought the opposite of, it has to start at a beautiful place. I had to get very used to, because by the time people see my work, it's maybe the fourth or fifth time I've drawn it. So the ugly iterations that come first is more of this conditioning to go through of like, stop expecting everything to be pretty. You know, things are going to be very ugly before they get pretty. So start with it ugly and embrace that ugliness and then move forward from there in baby steps.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. You know, I think sometimes you can get so caught up in the pre-thinking that you don't do. And I kind of like your approach of like, you know, let me do and then figure out where this concept leads me. I know for myself, I often get caught up in that. Let me think, overthink the concept and try to make sure it's all perfect on paper first. So I kind of like the opposite approach. And, you know, I think you've found that, you know, I've used the word freedom a couple times now, but I think you found that opposite workflow from where you were, but have kind of utilized some of the things you've learned there as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And it only gets easier as you get older and deeper into your craft, because looking back, like hindsight is 2020. So I look back now and I can look at pieces that people love or hate or whatever. And I know what the process of each one was, right? And I remember, I heavily dissect myself, where it, just like I dissect everything of music or movies or whatever, it's not enough for me to say, I don't like this. Me saying I don't like something without knowing why is a detriment to my education. Me disliking an episode of a show or a drawing of my own or a corner or whatever, and understanding why, like the deep reason why, that's what allows me to continue to take these quote unquote leaps forward, right? It's so important to understand why, because I look back all the way till I was a kid as such an opinionated kid. And I'm so lucky that I was taught very early that you can't criticize something unless you actually have a better solution. And I think when I start connecting those dots back, that's when I think that, like when I answer that question of like, how long have you been an artist? I feel like it's been as long as I've been human. Is I continue to, there were all these signs and flags that were raised early on in my life where it's like, I would talk shit. I would see something and I would be so opinionated on it. And then once I grew up, I realized that, you know, criticizing is great if you can offer a better solution. If not, then enjoy what's the best out there right now and move on. But I think part of being a creator is having such strong opinions on something.
Yeah, I agree with that, man. I think that those opinions are kind of what forms, in essence, a brand, right? Having that strong core principle is kind of what eventually, once you figure it out, molds itself into becoming what you're known for or the way that you come across. And I was curious, like, how does this way that you view your art kind of then move itself into the release process, right? So you have these works, maybe they were created in the past and have found a way forward. Maybe they're created for these specific purposes. How does that tie into the way that you view putting them onto the blockchain and then releasing them to be for sale?
Right. So a lot of this is still learning and shooting from the hip, obviously. Right. And it's, there are times where I know it's luck and there's times that I knew it was very methodical. And so it's interesting too, because there's the self that you're battling, which every artist should be and every human should be. But then there's also the, what I think we all deal with is dealing with the cadence and difference between the cadence between market maturity and innovation. And you have to, in a sense, like it's non-binary. It's the business side of myself understands that, okay, I must dance on this line so that I can satisfy both. And I can not only captivate, but I can pull, right? So captivate the current market maturity, but pull them forward inch by inch. And so there's a lot of things in Web3 that I currently disagree with, right? I feel that there's this mentality of say scarcity. And what's funny about that is I had recently heard a story about a rapper named MC Jin, and he had rapped on, you know, he had freestyled a lot on 106 in Park, and he was an Asian rapper, and he did so well. I think he won 6 freestyle battles in a row, and they indicted him into the, you know, 106 in Park, like Freestyle Hall of Fame. Then he got signed to Rough Riders and he released a single. And then after that, he had a backup single and he went to release the single right after. And this single was with Kanye West. And this was before Ye was Ye. And so what happens is Ye's label tells him that we're not going to release the single because Ye has too many singles right now. So this idea of scarcity isn't new to Web3. It's a suit mentality. I don't care if you wear a suit or you wear a t-shirt. A suit is a mentality, not your attire. And so what I want to battle against now, specifically on this day, is how to battle against people, suits telling creators to do less so that their value goes up. I think that's the wrong mentality. It's if an artist is alive and we understand that every day we wake up is a miracle and tomorrow is never guaranteed, all we want to do is extract more out of that artist to experience more of what they have to offer, experience more of the world through their lens. And I think that when business comes in, it becomes very interesting. You know what I mean? So it's that's one kind of I hope I'm not going too much on a tangent, but that's one facet of Web3 that I find a hurdle and a battle. The other thing is in Web3, there's the other thing to battle against, that it's the beautiful thing about comics, whether, you know, despite all of its flaws, business-wise and distribution-wise, is that when Giga came out, nobody had ever brought up that the price of the comic was $3.99. Never. It was about whether you were immersed in that story, whether you liked that story. And if you didn't, we had an agreement that you would walk away and I would continue to do what I do. There was never this... on top of that is when you sell 100,000 issues, they don't say, well, oh shit, well, this isn't going to be worth anything. No, they say, holy shit, the comic I believed in sold 100,000 issues. Let's fucking go. So it's like I think this goes back to what you asked earlier too, about like, has being an artist in the traditional art world taught me much or prepared me much for Web3? And honestly, I think it's kind of all... it's all connected here. You know what I mean? Because the releases on blockchain, yes, I do understand the game of making it methodical and you know, doing it in a way that is not tone deaf to the market and what people are going through and things like that. And I understand that the way it is right now, that collections that seem cohesive and methodical is what's going to give a buyer the most confidence. Where I hope we go in the future, though, is less about the specific series or the specific collection. We shouldn't make it so binary. It shouldn't be artist does X, therefore they can achieve Y. It should be artist does X, Y, Z, whatever it is, and they can still achieve A or whatever the variable is, right? And it shouldn't be one lane to success. I think that that's kind of what I hope most people think, is that, like, you know, there is the way I came in, but there's so many variables surrounding how I came in. It was timing. It was where the market was. It was where the people were. It was how I conveyed myself, all these things. And the game is different now. And we're not even a full year past my first mint. So I think it's, you know, how I think about releases right now, specifically with all those things that I mentioned, of the things we had to battle against, at least in what I feel like I had to battle against, is the biggest one for me, being a storyteller and a lover of comics and somebody that wants to get back to making comics, is that I think NFTs right now, our interpretation of it is extremely singular. And we believe that it's just a singular experience. There's a mint release date, there's an acquisition, and it's done. And it doesn't breathe again until you have a resale or a secondary sale or something like that. That is so anti-art. You know what I mean? And for me as a storyteller, I think the next releases I have coming up, the North Star for me is, how do I expand the current interpretations of what NFTs can do and what they can feel like? That's where I want to push. I don't think I can necessarily go on right now and just put out the even if I wrote the best comic ever, which the likelihood is likely zero. But even if I did that and I released it in Web3 before Web3 was actually ready for it, and there were tools accessible for somebody like me that doesn't have any coding experience or anything to be able to deliver and distribute that experience, I think it would be swept under the rug. It would X out all these people that don't give a shit about comics, never gave a shit about comics, and they're like, well, I'm going to skip on this one. I'm going to wait till he see what he does next. Or is it going to get to a point where people see an idea as a stepping stone? It's like, oh, this is what it can do. And then you push that further and further and further. So I think that's, for me, that's what I'm thinking about now. Of course, I do think about scarcity and things like that. But at the same time, I think part of the liberating nature of what I'm doing is not letting that dictate everything, right? There's times where I've pitched my next project to people and they think that it's a little too much, right? And that it's not going to do the same value. And I think that's wrong, because I think what I'm going to do next is I'm going to try to grow the culture of what art can do in Web3. And I truly believe that the money will always follow if we go culture first and allow the money to be an adverse effect of growing a culture.
All right. Yeah. You mentioned kind of like, you know, being at a spot where you want to push the culture, right? And utilizing that in your thinking more so than thinking about the sale itself, right? Thinking about how that sale actually impacts your ecosystem and drives you forward. How do you kind of start to map that out, right? Like each artist has individual goals, but where do you start that process of figuring out what your intentions are in that?
Yeah, and I think it's important to say that, like, you know, for me to even be able to think of my work like that is certainly a luxury and a privileged position, right? So it's not everybody gets to do that where they're like, oh yeah, well I don't need to make X amount this month, so I can just let my ideas breathe. That's kind of what I've worked so hard for over the last 12 years. So you know, just as a disclaimer, I think it is from a place of privilege. But then how I begin to map it out is I try to be very cautious of when I release stuff because of the luxury of my seat, is because I could drop an edition right after this call and I know that it would, you know, do fairly well. But then to do that without going onto the site first and scouring through Twitter of like, who has a release on this day or who has a release on this day? And I try to stay out of the way. Obviously, there are times where you can't do that, right? Where you just go and you have to just understand that that's just the nature of any business. And you can't be the nice guy forever or whatever. But in my seat, I feel like, you know, right now, I just think for me, it's just, you know, I need to let ideas breathe so that I can learn. I can learn the game. I can learn what the audience is going through. I can learn what the ecosystem is going through and what is acceptable or what has a likelihood to be embraced properly, you know? So for me, it's just kind of, you know, being in that privileged position, I just want to space things out to allow. There's so many factors, right? There's so many factors of like, okay, I released like the first edition and at first the price skyrockets to like 40 soul or something. And then having the privilege of being okay with it dropping to 10, right? And part of me loves that because I'm like, damn, well, somebody like me could afford something at 10, right? Before all of this. And so I don't exactly get nervous when it's down, but I think even as I say that, I'm like, dude, like that's probably just a luxury. You know what I mean? But the way I handle it and adapt to it is okay. Well, so I don't have like these, like kind of, I'm very grateful for not having the same mentality of a lot of people in crypto right now, because I think it would take the art out of it for me. Right. For me, it's, I've been living in a bear market of art for the last 12 years. And so when these kind of things happen and I look at the figures now, I'm just like, wow, like this was a dream paycheck back then. You know what I mean? And for all intents and purposes, it still is a dream paycheck. Like I'm getting paid to make marks on a page. So, you know, I'm sorry, I forget the root question.
yeah, just how you go about like kind of mapping out what you're after with these releases. I think you guys have done that really nicely. And I think one thing, not to put words in your mouth, I think is just like removing the greed from the situation. You know, it's like,
right.
I think so many people, especially in this traditional crypto viewpoint, they get, and I think not even inherently, you know, you start to see numbers, you get excited, and then that human nature kind of picks up. But I think you kind of have an important practice of being like, no, don't do that. You know, it sounds like.
Right. Yeah. And yeah, so how to map out things now is going to be a lot different than how I mapped out everything in the first year, right? The first year was all about culminating an audience, introducing them to my life and my career and my journey. And then there were, so if we start the first collection, that was the whole purpose of that. And before that, there was the Skeleton Crew airdrop that was to introduce myself. And the first collection was to really introduce myself. After that happened, and I'm just going to be fully transparent, so hopefully this sparks anything for anybody. But after, like, towards the end of the first collection, what I started to notice that I didn't hate, of course I loved and I benefited from, but the prices were getting kind of high, right? And I felt that due to the nature of auctions and stuff like that, that, you know, it was two things with Random Access hard drives. One was I wanted a collection in which I can release work without thinking so methodically about it. I wanted something where, okay, well, what if I woke up tomorrow and I'm like, I drew a dope warm up and I want to put this on chain and I want to allow somebody to hold it. But then there's also like, you know, what about works that weren't cohesive within the first collection or whatever, like any reason, right? Like, we're artists, we should have no bounds. So Random Access hard drives was to satisfy that part of myself, but also satisfy another part of myself. It's just putting things up for instant sale. So after doing all those things, you know, there was a couple collaborations here and there, but then there was Laidao, and Laidao was very much so that I could give face to this community that I really believed in, and so that kind of became like a stepping stone that allowed me to think of my next idea. But so now I think the mapping is going to be quite different. As I said, my North Star for the next year here, or next several years maybe, is to expand that interpretations of how long NFTs can go, what they're going to feel like, stuff like that. So now it's going to be kind of, I still want to give time for everything to breathe, not only for the audience and the fatigue and all that stuff to kind of let the dust settle and the hype go up and down or whatever. But then I also need time to make my best work. Right. And that's what I'm dealing with now. So the mapping now is probably going to be a little bit of, there's certainly Laidao is going to be a through line through everything, but then there's also going to be parts of myself where, okay, I just want to do something random. But then I think the big broad strokes of what's coming from me is to, how do I create a stepping stone of education to show people that NFTs can be more than just an auction ending or a big fast mint or any of those things, right? How do we make an experience last a whole month? Or 6 weeks or 2 months or 6 months, right? Like how do we tie that tension to last longer? Because I think if we do that, I personally think that, you know, we'll create, you know, the most beautiful thing about when TV shows really hit the home run, whether it's Breaking Bad or Game of Thrones or whatever, is it creates a virtual communal space where you don't really want to show up to your public place, whether that's a bar, office, Discord channel or whatever. You don't want to show up on Monday if you miss Game of Thrones on Sunday. How do we create those experiences in Web3? Because I feel like the infrastructure of Web3 really supports that experience, but nobody has really, maybe not to my knowledge, but from what I've seen, especially on Solana, nobody has really achieved long form experiences on the chain yet. And so I think what I will try to do is try to create these experiences that get longer and longer and longer until I'm like, okay, a comic could really work now in a way that, like, a comic can work in Web3, but my goal is to make it work outside of Web3 as well, right? Like, this is where the scarcity thing comes to mind. And I'm sorry if this is a tangent again, but like, in Web3, there's people in your ear of saying you don't want to release too much. You don't want to oversaturate yourself. On the other hand, the world doesn't give a shit about something that sold 2,000 units. They care when you sell 100,000 units, 200,000 units. That's when they care, because they're like, wow, it's not only the volume, but it's also the people that it affected. And now that's a direct customer base. So like, I feel like I'm very lucky to understand both that business part and the art part to a very high degree. And I try to just dance in between it and try to be very empathetic towards how I go about it and what I do about it. But, you know, to bring it back to the beginning, it's very much shooting from the hip. It's very much doing a thing, taking notes, watch other people do things and take notes, and then apply all that knowledge to what I want to put out next.
That's really cool, isn't it? So it's almost like it's been almost your entire life. And I think that's true for most artists, right? It's all an experiment that eventually leads to something that works. And then from that thing that works, you pick out what worked inside of there, and then take bits of that and add that up into a recipe that, you know, yeah, could lead to what is the next thing.
Right. And I think that's where being an artist, and hopefully being a human too, that's where integrity is huge. You know what I mean? Like, I think it's, you know, I notice in a lot of young artists is it's hard for them to admit when they got lucky, right? Me being older now, it's so visibly clear of when did I get lucky and when did I actually mean to do something? When was I actually methodical? So, you know, for me, it's just like, how do I continue to do things more methodically throughout, but also embrace the times when serendipity comes into play, and something where you couldn't be meticulous about planning it because it was too perfect, right? Like, it was something that just culminated through time and experience and sensing what people needed.
Yeah, I like that a lot. I think that is going to be important in Web3, right? I feel like a lot of people are going to get lucky, and a lot might not be the right word, but I think more people than in the traditional art world will get lucky, you know, whether that be a huge sale or a run of success. But it's about kind of what you get from that, what you learn from that, how you adapt that. I think you guys love that.
Yeah, it's about like two things, right? One thing you can't control, one thing you can control. We can't control when the luck happens. We just can't. There's no amount of money or anything that will give you luck. Luck will happen when it happens, and it'll be mercilessly, or, you know, it'll have no mercy when it doesn't happen. But the thing you can control is how prepared you are for that luck. Mm-hmm. Right. And that's where I'm so glad that I was so stubborn. Like, stubborn is a trait of mine, is that I drew things and I released things and I did things with the same conviction that I have now, but I did it when I was extremely poor. And I wouldn't be there if I wasn't so thick-headed, you know? So it's become a blessing. But I think that's really, you know, my lesson from that is that that's how I should have been doing it the whole time, is I was never wishy-washy about what I release, even when the audience was 10 people, when it was just my friends. I was very intentional, right? And I really wanted to evoke a feeling. And so that's something that I'm just grateful that it's kind of followed me throughout my career, is that I've always been so dumb enough to believe in myself, and to have such conviction that my lens is something that people will enjoy and be grateful for. And I think it's, you know, going all the way back of like, I wouldn't have that thought without my high school friends that didn't give a shit about art, or my corporate friends that didn't give a shit about art. Because what I understood when I was a kid, and maybe it happened in that cubicle when I was 22, but I realized that my quote unquote gift was something that there were certain people I love on this earth that will never see what I see. And I'm balanced and stable because I see what I see. You know, I see the real world, but I also see my imagination. And so at some point for me, art became less of a gift and more of a responsibility, that there are people on this earth that can't get to 6 o'clock when they clock out, because they don't see that, right? And so it became this big responsibility of like, how do I give my mom an escape? How do I give my sister an escape? How do I give my friends an escape from this job that they hate so much? How can I use my time to provide other people a sense of hope, and a sense of wonder and a sense of, you know, being comfortable in solitude.
Yeah, that's amazing, man. I think something that you talked about in the beginning was the way that storytelling and communication is so important. And that I think that just rings true for everything that you've been saying, you know, whether that be how you talk with the collectors, how you view what your artwork's message is. I feel like it all kind of ties back to those two things, right? Communication and then that story and feeling that you want to convey.
Right. And when I say storytelling, I think it's, especially now, there's this kind of like meta storytelling NFTs and stuff like that. And it's interesting because what I've meant about storytelling from my Web3 career till now was, what was the purpose, right? Like, my work was done. My style has been achieved. I know what I do. I know how I do it. But I'm trying to introduce a whole new group of people to me that have not been following me for years, because the way I view it is, I'm on an island right now, which is Web3, and there's the island where my previous fan base was, and there's no bridge. I'm working on building that bridge one, you know, brick at a time, if you will. But with that said, if you flew into a new town and you're the new guy, you have to at some point explain who you are, what's your narrative, what's your story. That's what I mean by storytelling. And that's what I really loved about my early days in Web3, and it's something I'll continue to do. But what I mean in storytelling in the marketing sense versus the art sense, the marketing sense is composing a story and captivating an audience with your story, because I do believe that each one of us has a story that proves that we are miracles. Every single one of us is a miracle, but so few of us have been able to break through the conditioning to feel that we are one of many. But in truth, we are one of none. We are all the main characters of our story. So in marketing, storytelling became really true to me, because then I realized that, oh, this is what I missed out on my whole career. Even though I was a lover of the juggernauts that do this best, which I find to be sports. Sports is so magical in the sense that, like, nobody, like I've said this so many times, but nobody actually cares about a ball going through a hoop in basketball. They care about the stories that take place on the court, because they know that if your team can come back when everything was stacked against them, why can't you make it through work tomorrow? That's the power of sports. And so then I started to realize that, wow, okay, you focused on storytelling in comics, in your work and all this stuff, but why haven't I ever applied my love of storytelling to my marketing? Right. And I think I did that in a blip of time on Twitch, where, you know, I was again culminating a new audience, and I was explaining to them who I was, how I became who I am, and where am I headed. And so it wasn't much different when I came to Web3. It was like, okay, I have all these new people that, okay, sure, they like the work, but I bet you they're going to like it even more when they realize where I came from and how hard this journey was and what I had to overcome, because then it'll make them feel like I place myself as the main character of my story to be a relatable character through different times of your career, right? Through the doubt, the fear, the loneliness, the lack of conviction, all the way to full of conviction, full of belief in myself. You know what I mean? That arc is something that I hope, you know, my intention is to inspire people, is to like, you know, there's times I remember when we made the last sale on the first collection, it was the last auction. And I think my tweet said that you can do it too. And that is the whole message, is that, you know, I started with nothing and somehow made something out of nothing. And so that's really, you know, it's very different from storytelling as a medium, though, as storytelling within art. Storytelling within art, to me, is there's the great storytelling mediums. There's episodic film, which is TV. There's film, which is obviously cinema and film. And then there's books, and then there's comics. And video games. We can't leave out video games. These are the juggernauts of storytelling mediums. That's what I mean when I talk about storytelling. Storytelling, can it be some prose text in a Discord? Sure. But then the foundation you lie upon is very thin. right? It's something that can't be globally felt. It can be very tight-knit corners. You can touch that audience, but you can't break through those borders by creating a story that everybody can relate to, right? So I think that's kind of what I've been so vague about. And I'm vague about it because I don't want to talk such a big talk until I do it. Once I do it, then I'll be like, okay, this is where we connect the dots. Okay, this is what I was pushing for the whole time. But yeah, that is going to be the focus as we kind of go from here.
It's almost like taking that brand that happens in a very niche corner and then figuring out a way for that to expand and its tentacles, if you would, to like grow to corners that might not even know what Web3 is, right? Like that's kind of what it sounds like is the goal. You kind of touched a little bit on this, but do you feel like the way that you have marketed yourself has changed from the beginning to now? Or do you think that you're still kind of like part of your success is writing that, like, this is my truth, this is how I want to keep going about it?
I think it's gotten more methodical and less luck. Right. So I would consider Twitch at a time where I wasn't methodical. I saw something happening and I also draw. So I'll set up a stream and I'll show people my process and stuff like that. What happened from then was luck, because then I realized that you're not just drawing the whole time. You have a microphone in front of you. Talk to people, talk to yourself, let them in on your world. And there were times where maybe I'm at a convention or I'm at a gallery and I tell my story. And it was just in conversation. I felt like that's what I'm supposed to say next in this humor interaction. And again, I attribute that to luck again, right? Whereas as now, it's something where, you know, I feel like it's, sorry, I do this tangent thing all the time and then I forget the root question.
That's all right. I was just saying, how do you feel like your marketing has changed, or do you feel like maybe that you've kind of been at this core ethos of like, this is who I am, and that's kind of what has guided you along this marketing journey for your work?
Right. So to continue from that, I don't think the marketing is going to change much from where it stems from, but I think it's going to get more tight and succinct of how I do it, right? More precise, more intentional, more being more methodical about how it's delivered and when it's delivered and stuff like that. So it's I think that's the only change it's going to go through. But then there's, you know, if we think about like, there's the variables that Web3 bring in, right? Where we spoke about it earlier about how to frame releases and how to, you know, deliver them in a way that you are investable, because that's what's hot right now is what is investable, not necessarily collectible. And I think, like, you know, just thinking about it now, I think what I realized early on in Web3 is that the more intentional your moves are perceived, the more upside it equates to in people's brains, right? So having a release calendar that was like a graphical thing, that's like, oh, wow, that this person's serious. And then and that's something I had done at the beginning, but then seeing what people have done now that I haven't done is I've seen people like create graphics of like the next bid and stuff like that. And like, this is all culminating that audience to believe that, oh, this is somebody that's very investable because they're thinking so methodically about every little thing that they do. And I think that, you know, those are the things that we have to do in Web3 right now. But I don't think, like I said earlier, I don't think it's going to change much of like how I go about marketing. It's just probably just going to become more mature as I grow up more and I understand the game more. But the root from what it comes from is always going to be me, right? I would think that, you know, the drawings, yes, they can stand on their own and they can make people feel things if they've never heard me speak. But the second you hear me speak and the second you see how I dress, the way I move, everything is like you enjoying my art is very much you enjoying the presence of me. You know what I mean? And I try to very much not create a dividing line between there so that when people do meet me, it's like this exciting thing. It's like, oh my God, you're exactly what I always thought you would be. You know what I mean? Like, it's no different. It's not a facade. It's genuine, you know? And so I think that's something I'm going to carry on throughout my career, wherever it goes next. It's just, I can't fix what was never broken, right? Like me being genuine and being transparent of my journey and how hard it's been and how other parts have been easier. That's what got me here. And I don't think there's any reason to kind of modify those foundational things, but it's more of, okay, how do I kind of observe this space and where it's going, and how do I tinker with that? Right. How do I tinker with the variables ahead of me rather than the foundation that I built?
Yeah. Right. It makes a lot of sense. Like, why would you rip up something that's already solid? Right. Mm-hmm. Why would you change something that something already has been built upon? So I completely agree with you there. And I think it's important to spend time on that foundation, which it sounds like you really have, like understanding not only yourself as an artist, but yourself as a human being and where these creations are coming from, what you hope that they accomplish and beyond, I think is very important for artists to understand. You know, it's like not just what makes that image, you know, it's like what makes that image volumes instead of just speak.
Right. And I think that's my concern at the moment of Web3 is that I understand we're in a bear market and I understand things are very hard. And again, I speak from a very heightened position of privilege, but at the same time, had I gotten this opportunity 10 years ago, I wouldn't even know what to do with it. Right. I wouldn't have the artistic integrity to take it to the next level. And then once I get there to the level after that, so it's the time that we spend on the ground floor is so invaluable. You know what I mean? Because it really, like, I love what you just said, because it really is, it's not just what it teaches you about you. Like the reason why I love drawing isn't just because of what it's taught me about craft and affecting people and stuff like that. It's the simple act of drawing has taught me so much about me. Right. Like some of the things that I find so profound is that, like, I used to have anger problems. I used to be very impatient, very jealous, all these negative things. And I don't know when it happened, but one day it dawned upon me that no drawing ever got better because I was angry or because I was jealous or because I was fearful, or none of them ever got better because I was impatient. Right. And so it kind of allowed me to have this mirror that I sat in front of so long to teach me about myself. And okay, these are the things, like, because there's so much tedious time that goes into drawing that, you know, if spent wisely, you're thinking to a deep level of, like, why am I doing this? What is the point of all of this? Right. Like, why do it again? And so, you know, it's the fact that my medium has been able to be a mirror to make me a better man. I think that's, for me, that's the goal, right? And to bring it back to the concerns of Web3 is, yes, we have this beautiful tool that has a great infrastructure that kind of breaks all the broken thing, or fixes and mends all the broken things from traditional art world of only having a primary sale, never having an infrastructure for secondary sale or a royalty via smart contracts or all these things that Web3 helps. What scares me is, if I had gotten into this when I was 16, yes, liberated because it's more than just posting something on Instagram and having it dissolve into the ether. But at the same time, would I know when to stop thinking about monetization? You know, like, but you know, the next generations are always going to be smarter, right? Because, like, I used to be scared of digital art because I was like, there's too many brushes. Right. There's too many things I can do here. And there's not just, oh, the one I can afford. Right. So it's like, it, as the generations go on, I'm sure they'll be able to, like, self-discipline themselves more. But, like, something that I started kind of talking about a couple months back was that to break things down into simple shapes, as I do in drawing. If I look at Web 2 destroyed the need to be in the same geolocation as your audience. Right? It allowed worldwide communication and distribution. That's one tool that you throw into your toolbox. And then when I look at Web3 is a tool to monetize and distribute and to create an infrastructure where sales can go beyond primary sale. but none of those tools, Web 2, Web 3, none of those tools are tools to actually make the art, right? And you, and we don't need Web 3 to share the art, right? Web 2 works perfectly for that. There's no reason for Web 2 to change in how they share art. Sure, there are business things and political things of having, you know, the fact that Twitter being an ad model or Instagram being a pay-to-play ad model of how much can you boost your content versus the other people boosting their content with a more amount of money or something. So those things Web3 can help fix, of course, but at the end of the day, none of these tools, I think, make me a better artist. It makes me a more celebrated artist. It makes me a more widely loved and renowned artist, but none of them make me better as an artist.
I like the looking at these things as tools, right? I think it's really important that we make sure that people realize that, you know, it is still at the end of the day, these human beings. And I always say that we're very lucky because we get to actually live the same timeline as these artists that are getting to release this amazing work. You know, in the past, that wasn't the case. You know,
yeah.
We've kind of had this door opened up where we are lucky enough to be able to have these conversations. We are lucky enough to be able to peer deeper into the minds of these artists. And I think that oddly enough, it didn't exist as much with Web 2, but for some reason it does with Web 3. And I think that's the blessing that I really like to look at. And I hope that more people do realize that and use it as a tool for the human aspect versus just the money, you know, just the making money, yeah. Because it will easily lose itself if you stay there.
Yeah. And that's what we were talking about earlier too, of like the suit mentality of these finance guys telling me how much art to release, you know, or playing advisors and stuff. And it's just like, some of them have good hearts. I've met some of them. I shook hands with them. I've hugged them. I've thanked them. Some not so much, you know what I mean? And so it's very, it's going to be a very interesting path for all of us to kind of pave and decide what is right and what is wrong. But you know, I think it's going to be fascinating, but you know, I think what's dope about it all is we don't do any of this alone. You know what I mean? There's plenty of people that really get it from a different level. And yeah, like you said, man, I mean, some of the old tropes of being an artist is like, oh, they're not celebrated until they're dead. Okay. Web 2 and Web 3 help aid this issue. I think Web 2 has done it quite a bit too, right? Web 2 has, there's a lot of people that have gotten jobs at, you know, big game studios or film studios that were in a small village in Brazil, right? So it has allowed those things to happen. But then because of the lack of infrastructure built for creators, I think that's where Web3 comes in, right? Where we can really take all this good that Web2 allowed of worldwide communication and distribution and combine that with an infrastructure in which, you know, the age of the starving artist could be over if we want it to be, if we actually want it to be. And that I always put it on people at the end there because we have to want it to be over. And I'm not so naive to think that we all want it to be over. Some people are very happy of the struggle it takes to be an artist and all those things and where it puts them in life and all those political things.
Yeah, I think too, it's important to have people, you know, Web3 is such a broad thing, right? To have people who do focus in on making those toolings. And I'd be remiss, and we're almost at time here. I don't want to keep you too terribly long, but
yeah, no worries.
I want to kind of round things here because I don't think it would be possible without people making these tools for us as artists. You know, you mentioned earlier, like, you're not a developer, you're not a coder. That's not the world in which you want your mind to be occupied. You know, you have this mission for that. And I'm just curious on if there's things that you've learned in interacting with, you know, A2K, Milst, ExchangeArt, the whole team there, who, like, I feel like for me personally, releasing art on Solana wouldn't be the same without these people who are focused on making these tools. And I would say about Web3 in general is those tools have to be created for us, the artists.
Right. Yeah. And yeah, no, absolutely. Exchange has been what I would consider a huge pillar in the foundation I've been able to build. Without them, there's countless things I would be able to do. And not only in building the tools, but also, you know, I believe that a lot of people at Exchange also try to find collectors for certain artists, you know, or for all their artists. They just have to find a collector that matches with that person or that art style or whatever. And it's something I'm extremely grateful for. And to expand that even further, I get so grateful for role players in this space. You know what I mean? I think we've seen a lot of people come in for X reason. X reason didn't work out, and they never get to Y. They just leave. Yeah. The people that find Y and find Z, and then Y and Z is going to fulfill X. It's, you know, not to speak like such a word problem, but like it shows how much these people believe in this space, that they're willing to invest their time into things like even this kind of show. Like, we need this kind of stuff. We need good journalism. We need good sound art critics to help the common person understand something more, right? To understand what is good and what is bad. We need all of these role players, and we need all these tools. And yeah, Exchange has, working with Exchange over the last year has been an experience like I haven't really had. There's been a lot of companies that spoke to me in a way that made me feel like they were listening, but then their actions wouldn't really show it, right? And maybe that's because back then my ideas were shit or whatever. But then I feel like these days, whenever I bring up something to A2K or Mills or anybody at the Exchange team, I feel like it's a very fruitful conversation, right? It's both sides have a very good reason of why they feel the way they do, and there's this, what I feel is there isn't this judgment towards ideas here, right? Especially when I deal with Exchange, there's this curiosity. If I don't like something, even if they love that thing, I feel they genuinely want to understand why I dislike that and why I think the tone needs to be changed, right? And so I don't know if that's just, I try to be so conscious of like when I'm speaking from a position of privilege, but like I feel that that's something I just haven't experienced in my career where like whether my publisher really listened to me or the platform like Twitch, did they ever really listen to me? You know what I mean? Like those things. So it's like, it's incredible to work with a team that believes in independent art on chain as much as the Exchange team does, you know, and it's one of those things that those, like I said, the role player kind of thing in the space, like that's what helps me sleep at night, right? I can just continue to focus on how do I deliver the best experience that gets people through an emotional hurdle or whatever. And then there's people building tools every day. I'm sure several tools that I don't even know of at the moment, but they're building tools to help me create better experiences, more thoughtful experiences. So it's, you know, it's, yeah, working with Exchange has been a huge blessing to be able to do that.
Yeah, you know, it's so funny too, because I think we can get disconnected, right, and not know just whether it's ourselves or you know, our situation or the grander situation at hand. But I've really found that to be something that I think is why I got pulled into working with Exchange as well, is that actually wanting to listen, you know, not just taking a comment that someone says and like kind of shoving it to the side, like it feels like so many do, but right, actually able to like digest, even when someone's maybe not a fan of what you're doing. Cause I've often been I joke around, I'm like, how did they ever hire me? I was just yelling at A2K in the DM for months. And then all of a sudden they were like, hey, you want to come with us? And I was like, sure, I guess.
No, but I think it's a great move
to look at things with a critical lens. You know, I think it really does, like, it benefits everyone involved, you know, to have that be the best kind of tool or product or whatever for the people who are actually using it.
Yeah. And honestly, it's it's helps what I think it's must have helped so many artists start on Solana so much easier than it was back in the day. You know what I mean? That's not to say I'm not grateful for, certain entities before, like Olaplex, which hosted my entire first collection. None of this would be possible if an artist had to raise capital or learn coding to develop a marketplace, develop smart contracts. Like all the bottleneck on innovation would be so tight at that point. Whereas companies like Exchange open up that bottleneck a bit so that you can focus on what's most important, is making the best work you've ever made. It's just something I'm very grateful of. And I'm grateful that they, of course, every business, even my own business, you have to be conscious of your numbers and what benchmarks you hit, what benchmarks you don't hit, and how to hit those benchmarks. But to do that while also being a decent human and being empathetic towards your customers, whether they're collectors or creators, I think that's what sets them apart, right? They genuinely listen. They genuinely take notes. When they say they're going to bring it to the team, they're going to bring it to the team. You know what I mean? So I think we're real lucky to kind of be building this future alongside so many of you,
Yeah, I don't think it would be possible. In fact, it would not be possible without yourself and all of the other creators who come with what they have to bring. That's the kind of the point is, right? We can all balance each other out. I like what you said with the role players, because I think whether we realize it or not, we all do play a role, whether that's just someone on Twitter liking, commenting, retweeting, whether that's another artist being inspired by something another artist has done, it all kind of makes this inspiration ecosystem, which I find to be extremely important.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're about here with the time, and I really, again, thank you so much for spending an hour here with me today and just kind of diving in. I love hearing your perspective on things, the way that you kind of view yourself as a human being first, and then how that pours into the artistry, because I think that's extremely important to remember. It's like, that's what sets us apart from AI, right? Is we are human beings.
Yes.
We are the original AI, if you would, but yeah. we are a human being. And I think that really dictates so much of our path, and we can't forget that.
Absolutely. It all starts from there, and that's what is going to continue to set us apart, each of us apart from each other too. You know what I mean? Because we all have such wildly different upbringings and life experiences. And I think that's, sorry to tangent again, but I always find it like, I have such, not all my friends are artists, you know what I mean? So I'm always grateful for the perspective that they bring, but when they do get into that creative muscle and they think that, what place do I have in the art world? Because I came from this and I came from this. And I was like, dude, those are things I've never heard any other artist come from. That's why you're going to be powerful. You know what I mean? And it truly is that, is if we all understood how truly each one of us is a miracle and how great our story is, we just had to communicate it in a way that can be captivating enough for people to listen and be curious about, we would have a very fruitful society.
I'd like to think that we're building it here,
Yes.
One step at a time.
Yeah.
If you could leave us with one final tip for artists that are either planning to come to Solana or are here trying to build themselves as a brand, as an entity, what would it be?
It's always such a blanket thing, but I think it's something so much harder to do than to actually put into practice. But just believe in yourself, trust yourself, love yourself. I think these are all things that, for good reason, right? Quote unquote good, but the world conditioned us in a way in which we can control things in a certain way as a society, and that has its good things, right? That's why I was able to buy coffee next door. And I'm able to do it again tomorrow morning. But, I think that the hardest part of my whole life of learning how to do was believing in myself and loving myself. And I think once I was able to do that, the art kind of just followed through. Of course, you had to work on your craft, and you had to work on, in the business sense, you had to worry about business stuff, but if the root is damaged, it's very hard to get to the other parts. You know what I mean? So if you can love yourself and accept yourself and then give yourself time to learn craft, to learn business, then you already have the foundation of belief. So yeah, my fortune cookie would just be believe in yourself.
I love that. I think it's easy to forget, man. It really is. It's so very simple. Often the simplest advice is the most effective.
Absolutely agree.
Well, thank you so much again for joining us today. And this was the first episode here of the Artist Workshop series. And I'm really excited for others to be able to listen back on this. Just pull out the little bits of what drives you, because I really do feel like there was so much value that you mentioned just from your journey. I think that often these talks on Twitter Spaces and on Discord and whatever, while they're great, they can be rather shallow. So it's nice to be able to spend this time to go one deeper into that level of artistry, of humanity, and what really drives you. So thank you for just being here, for being vulnerable, for taking the time. It really means the world to us.
Of course. And thank you so much for having me, guys. I very, very grateful. Thank you.